Thank you so much to everyone in BC for submitting your art. It's absolutely beautiful, and it's amazing to have artists from all across Canada included in tonight's show. We are very thankful to have you all join us today and manage to get around those pesky time zones. Does anyone have any questions for our artists in BC? Someone says oceans of emotion is incredible, absolutely beautiful. Thank you, Persia and Ross. Beautiful. Excellent pieces. There's a lot of support in the chats. So many people are saying thank you and amazing to all of your amazing talent for all of you. Incredible artwork. Someone said that your artwork is all very touching. Our very own Melissa has said, we are grateful to have you as new members to our BIS community. Welcome.
You are a champion here, Mark.
Thank you. Thank you all. We'll go on mute because we have a lot of feedback.
Thank you, everyone.
All right. Sorry, give me one moment to just switch my screens. I'm kind of all over the place tonight. At this time, I would like to welcome Scott. Scott is a member with BIST in Toronto.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Scott. How are you doing?
Okay. Just what day is it today? It's hard to identify lately, I've found, in 2021. Today is Wednesday. Yes. And I've had a lot of time on my hands. In 2021, and my art has actually decreased. I think that I was more active probably up until January. But for the year of 2020, I was quite active. And I found a relaxing state in creation. I did take art in high school. I'm turning 40 in a month, so that was a long time ago, and I attended the Ontario College of Art and Design briefly, and I sustained my brain injury in August of 2019 in a catastrophic car accident, that of which I'm very grateful to be alive, and it's a miracle that I survived. And I sustained a micro bleed in my brain, and it's been interesting recovering, with, I believe, a high capacity, almost high enough to think and not be aware that it's there, but I have identified through tests that I have, a very low concentration level. And when I found that out, I found that it made sense as to seeing my attention span and my ability to listen, my desire to speak a lot and to share. But I did find that I had a level of positivity that was higher, a level of acceptance and positivity that was higher. And that kind of changed a little bit when the pandemic really set in. And that affected me in a way, in the interpersonal relationship level, that I understood more afterward. And that's kind of where my creativity kind of backed down. This piece here, Oceans of Emotion, is a piece I tuned up. I actually made that years ago, but I tuned it up during 2020. I built a frame for it. And then Orion's Bow, I did in early 2021. And I'm not sure, are those the only two pieces that you have there? Okay, that one is hanging in the room behind me. That one I did years ago and I tuned up in 2020. And I kind of got it ready to hang. And then that fell apart due to some of those interpersonal relations that I've, the mechanisms that have been heightened by my brain injury. This piece, I tend to work in layers. So what started out, this is a found canvas that I got at probably Value Village years ago. And probably under there are like two or three other paintings, and it turned out to be that. So there's like a stencil of enamel spray paint. I think there's bingo ink in there. The blue is oil paint. And then I think dollar store acrylic is that pink stuff. And it's got kind of, when I, it's the art that I do is abstract, color based with kind of what I have. And landscapes kind of tend to come out, I find, out of just going with no representation. And I see kind of like a weird, like bed with floating orbs, but I'm sure a lot of people will see other things. It would be a piece that you'd need to see in person to kind of get the, some of the texture that's there. These pieces I did, so the one on the left, glaciers, is actually on a tarp that's stretched over some found frames that I picked up. And that is acrylic and spray. And then the one on the right, that was kind of at a height. I was at a heightened spot. And then these ones here, the Winter of Confusion, that would have been probably one of my last pieces that I did. And that spray and house paint, some oil paint in there. And you can see kind of how the landscape turns, same with the Pyramid Lake there. I tend to use like construction materials. So like home caulking I'll use, because it's got, it's like a palliative medium. And I kind of just, I like bright colors, always have. And yeah. And I'm so grateful to be involved. It's given me something to do. It's actually taught me something about, I have a bit of a mechanism where I don't believe in myself and don't take risks. And had I not emailed in this, I wouldn't be here today. You guys would not have been seeing that material that I worked on. I have a stack of art that's just kind of sitting in my garage and in the suburbs. And it's unfortunate because that was a lot of work that I did with a good state of mind. And I have like a bit of a blockade where I can't really get it out into to show. And but yeah, you know, I'm trying to be positive. Had you talked to me this time last year, you would be speaking to a different energy, but I can still, you know, I can still smile and I can still connect with it. And it's so important to be grateful to be alive, to be grateful for our loved ones, to really find the simplest gratitudes. And I was at really, really embraced in that energy. And you know, I think there's a thing that they talk about where until something's kind of gone, you don't realize what was really there. And to kind of go through that at this point in my life has been kind of like the perfect storm. So in remembrance of that great positive feeling, I dedicate that positivity to all that are here and all that have sustained brain injuries in their life, to remember that everything can be as simple as one day at a time, one moment at a time, and to find the littlest things that bring joy to our minds and hearts, and to share that with others.
Thank you so much, Scott. The chat box is just blowing up with comments, you know, an expression of how you've been able to use materials in ways that people had never thought of. There's comments about how your art actually provokes memories and thoughts of you know, personal feelings or places that they have been themselves. Porcelain cloud, someone says, looks like a perfect piece sitting above the bed. Someone else has said that they're glad that you found the courage to share, and they're really encouraging you. There's so much encouragement, I have to say, to keep up the good work. People are exclaiming about appreciating the positivity. Even I have to say, I know that you're an excellent artist, in this medium, but you're also really great with words. And I think that that's been really impactful for a lot of our members. Someone has said, thank you for taking the risk of being here and showing your vulnerability and touching my emotions. And there's, again, just so many thank you, thank you, thank you. Yes, and there's a lot of love here.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you so much, Scott. This is absolutely
Thanks to everybody.
Incredible.
Thanks to everybody for being here, right? It's this is a new time for everyone that's alive right now. And I think that we have to be grateful for where we are, given that it's a big planet. It's a very big planet. And every individual is unique and has their own path of experience and suffering, and but we all have the human condition. So I think it's always beneficial to not doubt and to have faith and positivity. And and one thing that I like when I'm saying that, I just automatically like apply it to myself. It's I'm a master at beating myself up. Clubbing and clubbing and clubbing away, and 2021 has kind of been like that for me, and I know that I'll get out of it, and but I got to be grateful, right? I got to be grateful. There's so many different experiences that everyone else has, and to see some of them, gives an
it's
understanding,
so true,
an understanding, yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's so true. And yeah, what a great way to start to build those connections within that community. But I want to say thank you, Scott, for being here. And thank you for sharing your incredible work.
My pleasure. My pleasure.
Thank you. At this time, I would like to welcome a newer member of BIST who has graciously contributed some of her incredible art for this evening. Please welcome Melanie.
Hi. How are you?
Melanie?
Helps if the mute's not on, eh? How are you? Nope,
not bad.
Just gonna move in line. There we go.
Oh, so I talk. Hi, my name is Melanie. I've been an artist for almost my whole life. I got meningitis when I was 19, so I was paralyzed in a wheelchair for quite some time. And from that, the brain swelling, I have like short-term memory loss, which has been quite hard to navigate in my 20s and now 30s. But I found a way to deal with it through art. Actually, I went to art school and I found my artist voice again there, where I kind of lost it before. And it's been hard, I'm not gonna lie, but I've been able to do a lot of commission work, which has been really encouraging. This piece here, The Rats in My Brain, is about dealing with the struggles of having brain injury. The rats represent the obstacles that you faced dealing with brain injury. She kind of has like the person, it doesn't have to be any gender, but the person in the image kind of has like a very blank stare because the rats in their brain kind of run their life sometimes. And the rats for me represent like pain, they represent distress, they represent all kinds of just turmoil, I guess would be the word. And they kind of turn a wheel in your brain and they can run rampant sometimes, but it's about learning to live with them rather than let them run you, I guess. Just like it's like dealing with brain injury. I don't know. For me, my experience is I'm not gonna get over it. It's gonna always make me feel some type of way, but I'm gonna learn to live with it. And I am learning to live with it basically. So it's gonna be ongoing. That's about it.
Thank you so much, Melanie,
for sharing your work. It is stunning, and there are so many comments coming in with everyone talking about how proud of you they are, how powerful your piece is. Does anyone have any questions for Melanie at this point?
I would like to know, which medium do you prefer to use?
I prefer acrylic because it's most forgiving. Oil I enjoy, but it's just very frustrating, and watercolor is just out of the question for me because it drives me insane. But acrylic is very forgiving for me, so I like it. You just wait 10 seconds and then you can just fix your mistake.
Thank you.
Someone in the comments said they would love to see more of your artwork. Someone else said, Mel, thank you for being here and sharing your creativity and yourself. And from Juliet from BC, I love your work, Melanie, and the symbolism behind it.
Thank you. That means a lot to me.
At this time, we would like to invite Phyllis Go. Her pronouns are she, her. She is a certified in oncology registered nurse who cares for breast cancer patients. She is a patient advocate for integrated care and accessible spaces, and is currently on the organizing committee of the first North American conference on integrated care by the International Foundation for Integrated Care in Toronto on October 4th to 6th, 2021. Phyllis is presently completing a self-acquired brain injury book while also volunteering in her community to assist the homeless. In her spare time, she enjoys painting acrylics on canvas and uses art as therapy for her disability. Phyllis has submitted a video for us to enjoy this evening.
Oops, sorry.
Hello, my name is Phyllis Go. Welcome to my presentation for the Brain Injury Society of Toronto Virtual Expressive Art Show. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. I am a certified oncology registered nurse who cares for breast cancer patients. This is actually a picture of me at work. I am currently on medical leave due to an accident that caused me to have a brain injury. I'm currently busy with therapy and doing volunteer work to help stimulate my brain. Within my volunteer work, I am an accessibility and patient advocate, and during my spare time, I enjoy to paint with acrylic on canvas. I wanted to give you an overview of the set of paintings that I have done titled Tranquility in the City. After I speak about each of the five paintings, I will provide some time for you to take in and have a closer look at each painting. Each of these paintings are scenes of Toronto in the year 2020, when the COVID-19 pandemic is raging.
I think Mary's frozen, and so the video's frozen.
Okay.
Give it a second. Sorry, everybody. We knew there'd be a technical difficulty tonight, and here we are. I'm going to try and get in touch with Mary offline. Yeah. Melissa, if you want to introduce maybe the next person.
Absolutely. The next person that we're going to introduce to everyone this evening will be Graham. So Graham has also submitted a video, but I'm wondering, because we're having a little bit of a challenge, I'm wondering if I can play it on her behalf. And thank you everyone for your patience. I think that, as Melissa said, I think that to a degree, we've kind of been prepared for the possibility of some technical challenges, but we're just gonna roll with them, I think. Let's see. Yes, isn't that true, Laura? Laura says that patience is something that they've all learned. I'm also not as talented as our lovely Mary when it comes to all of this, but Graham, I hope that I do this a service to you. And after the video, we'll have a chance to talk to Graham a little bit.
Sorry, Melissa.
That's
you
okay.
Got it? Okay.
Oh, no.
There's no volume.
Melissa?
Oh no.
It's okay. Ooh, breathe. If you stop sharing, Melissa, if you stop sharing, and then when you go to share again, there's a little button that you click that says to include volume. So I think you just have to reshare it.
I'm going to try with the headset off.
It's not shared, Melissa.
On the preview.
I know, she needs to push present.
Oh. You're not unmuted, are you?
Oh.
Thank you, Graham, so much. I apologize to everybody for some of the technical difficulties there, but I think we all still got to experience the incredible, incredible artwork. Graham has been contributing to our art community this past year. He did some work for us around the holidays. We're so, so grateful to you, Graham, for being a part of our community and for sharing this. I put it in the chat box. And sorry, Melissa, that I'm talking right now. I know you're organizing behind the scenes, but I did put in the chat box that we'll make sure this video goes up at www.bist.ca/art so that you guys can feel free to watch it again, because it really is a bit of a masterpiece. So again, thank you, Graham, for that.
Yes, I've actually seen this video a few times, and every single time it absolutely blows me away. The work that Graham has put into this is incredible. Graham, do you want to say a few words about the about your art or about the video?
Sorry, it took me a second to unmute.
I hear you with those tech.
Well, most people who know me know it's hard to keep me quiet, let alone try and get me to talk. Everything there and some more were done in preparation for this event. And as it turns out, I think I have certainly over 100 pieces, so everybody in attendance can get one. And they're all available as digital prints, which ultimately means they're inexpensive and they can be shipped directly to people's homes. It's all digital art done on my iPad. It's even more forgiving than acrylics. You just click undo, and I just thank BIST for this opportunity because art is therapy. And as I was told, it avoids time travel for people with MTBIs. We can either be stuck in the past bemoaning what we've lost or worried about what the future holds. I encourage anyone, take up art, get into the moment, and ultimately enjoy the process. Thank you, Melissa.
And thank you, Graham. Thank you. And I do apologize for the technical stuff on my end. Unfortunately, I was able to make it beautiful too late. So I apologize, but we do have it on our website. And again, thank you so much, Graham. Your work truly is absolutely astonishing.
There is, there's one question in the chat box. I just want to make sure that gets answered before we move on. So someone in the chat room wants to know how long you've been painting. Or doing your art pieces.
Are you hearing me?
Oh, sorry. I should have rephrased it. How long have you been doing your art?
Yeah. Okay. So I'm afraid I started dipping my hands in my diapers, I'm told, and doing wall murals. So finger painting, but I really didn't get a lot done until my March 2018 accident. And of course, then you have the time. And I can tell you, painting or drawing every single day, same maybe with writing, it's really amazing what that discipline does for you, not only in healing, but in honing your craft.
Thank you. So I'm going to say one more thing, Melissa, and then pass it back to you and Noor, so I apologize. But one of the things I think the BIST community adores so much about our members, beyond the art, beyond, you know, all the other things you bring to our community, humor is so important at BIST. And I encourage everyone to go through the comments that happened after Graham made the diaper comment, because pretty funny. It's pretty funny stuff. So not only did you bring your art, but thank you for the humor you brought to tonight as well.
Thank you.
Okay, so we've just been working behind the scenes, just kind of fixing some stuff. So Mary, if you're ready to go, I kind of left it up to Mary, so it's gonna be a little bit of a surprise for everyone. So I'll wait for her to pull up her screen.
All right. Hi, everyone. Sorry about that. I don't know how much of Phyllis's video did we see.
Nothing. Not really.
So we're going to try that again. Here we go.
Perfect. And thank you again, everyone, for your patience.
Okay.
Hello, my name is Phyllis Goh. Welcome to my presentation for the Brain Injury Society of Toronto Virtual
Expressive Art. Screen share.
Let me tell you a little bit about myself.
Is it not working?
No. The screen's not shared. I see everyone's beautiful face, but I don't see the screen.
Okay. There we go.
There we go. Oh, now we see your emails. Okay. There we go.
Okay. I am a certified oncology registered nurse who cares for breast cancer patients. This is actually a picture of me at work. I am currently on medical leave due to an accident that caused me to have a brain injury. I am currently busy with therapy and doing volunteer work to help stimulate my brain. Within my volunteer work, I am an accessibility and patient advocate, and during my spare time, I enjoy to paint with acrylic on canvas. I wanted to give you an overview of the set of paintings that I've done titled Tranquility in the City. After I speak about each of the five paintings, I will provide some time for you to take in and have a closer look at each painting. Each of these paintings are scenes of Toronto in the year 2020, when the COVID-19 pandemic is raging. When lockdowns are in effect and the streets are desolate, the emptiness of the images are to show the effects of the lockdowns. The scenes also have birds to illustrate how nature is returning during the pandemic. They also illustrate the freedom that we still have, such as personal freedom, democracy, and free healthcare. Because there are places around the world that do not have the freedoms we do, and we should be grateful. This is the first painting in the series of five titled Red Brick District. This is a scene of the Distillery District in downtown Toronto. On the right side of the canvas, there are tall red brick buildings, and on the left, shorter red ones. Down the left center of the canvas is the red cobbled street, while on the right center is the stark empty cement sidewalk, which is normally bustling with people. Closer to the viewer at the center is a black and metal chair with four brown birds resting and enjoying the beautiful weather and the blue sky. This second piece is titled Flying Out of Darkness. This scene is part of Harbourfront in downtown Toronto at night. In the background, there are condominiums with various lights on. Across the center of the canvas is the Harbourfront wave deck walkway, illustrating a wave of emotions that some people are experiencing during the pandemic. At the lower center of the canvas, two birds are flying above the Lake Ontario water, illustrating the freedoms that we have in our first world society. The lights from the road lamps illustrate hope, hope for a cure for COVID-19, hope that things will return to some type of normalcy, and hope that we can one day see our family and friends to give them a hug soon. This third piece is titled Night at the Six, and the scene is at night during the winter in front of Nathan Phillips Square in downtown Toronto. The curved twin buildings surrounding the saucer-shaped council chamber is City Hall, which in this painting has all its lights on. There are various hotel and business buildings on the right side of City Hall with some of their lights on as well. The Toronto Maple Leaf signage is lit up in white and red respectively. There is some reflection of the night's light on the cold, wet concrete plaza ground. The skating rink that would normally be busy in the evening is now empty as we stay in our homes to keep each other safe. And there are two birds showing how nature is returning during the lockdowns. The fourth piece is titled A Streetcar Named 504, a wordplay from the stage play titled A Streetcar Named Desire. The scene is of the back of the 504 streetcar at night on one of its routes in downtown Toronto, just after it rained. The emptiness of the streetcar is to show the effects of the lockdowns, especially the 504 streetcar in the evening when it is usually filled with people. And if you look closely, you will see two pigeons on either side of the streetcar.
Oops.
Sorry, it cut off. I think we've got most of it though, so maybe we can. Phyllis, there's one more painting and that's on her webpage and it's lovely. So sorry about the technical difficulties and I'll throw it back to you, Melissa.
Okay, thank you, Mary. I think that's just kind of, there's two themes tonight. There's technical challenges and incredible amounts talent. So we're just going to roll with it and just, yeah. I want to take this time. Let's just take a breath. And I want to just invite an absolutely lovely artist who I'm sure that some of you remember from one of our previous community meetings, but she is here to talk about her work. Please welcome France. France is a person who has acquired a brain injury. She uses her lived experience to help others cope and heal from similar wounds. Built on her own recovery experiences, France launched Standing By Your Side, a concussion support group in 2017, and she started her own coaching services. That same year, she became a yoga teacher, and a few months later, she pursued training in acquired qualification as a restorative yoga teacher. In 2020, in August, after a year of online education, France became a certified health and life coach, and her desire is to support people create their best life. Creative abstract explorer, writer, and international speaker are some of the passions she enthusiastically embraces on a regular basis. And as a beauty seeker, France loves surrounding herself with original and one-of-a-kind items. Spirituality is a part of her life, and you can find many inspirational quotes or maxims on France's wall guiding her to stay on course with her dreams. Please welcome France.
Thank you so much, Melissa. I'm so delighted to meet all of you tonight and with all the artists who are present. For me, I came to art after I had my brain injury, same thing with starting to write. I have no formal education, and I'm also very passionate about not seeking any formal education at this point in my exploration. I really believe that my art is it's inside of me and is finding its way out as I follow my inspiration and my guidance. I like to paint with bold color. I love also to insert some nature element in my art. So sometimes it could be leaves or flowers. I love to use some threads and some words from like book then I ripped apart. I love to work in silence most of the time. And when I start painting or when I start to do my art exploration, I will like write words in the background. This is something that one of my teacher like taught me. And I love this idea to leave a trace behind that only me and what's the expression is there. So I rarely give like a title to my pieces, and I follow my heart. For me, it's very important to just leave my brain on the side and just go with the flow and see what is coming out. And most of the time I'm very surprised very surprised to have this talent that was hidden from me. Thank you, Melissa, for offering me like a platform to showcase my art, and I'm so grateful to be here tonight with all of you. Thank you.
There are. I'm just going to go rolling back through the comments. Whoops, my apologies. Yeah, people are absolutely loving your work. Oh, a lot of comments are beautiful, beautiful, unique work. One of the things that I notice is that from how it appears is that it's sort of a multimedia art. Is that correct?
Yes, it is multimedia. So yes, as I said, sometimes it could be ink, sometimes it could be pastel. Sometimes, as I said, like I will take some nature element. I will do some threads in it. So whatever, like, you know what I feel like doing that day, like, you know, I just follow my inspiration and my guidance, or sometimes I look around me to see what kind of material I could use to to paint. And as I said, I try to go without my head as much as possible because I used to be in my head all the time. So I want my senses to be there. And as you mentioned, Melissa, beauty is very important for me. So for me, by creating something different and something that comes from my heart, I believe, like, you know, then people could appreciate, like, you know, seeing, like, you know, whatever they want, because it's abstract, you could find your own definition or your own story in this pieces.
Yes, that's one of the most beautiful parts of art, but especially in abstract art, you're correct. Thank you so much, France. I truly appreciate it. There are so many lovely words. I encourage you to go through the chat. But just before we run, I'm going to give you a couple of questions. So again, someone is asking about your social media. So they're wondering what your Instagram handle is on social media.
Okay, perfect. I will put it like in the chat.
So, amazing.
Yes. So I love to share on my social media. I share my artwork, but I also share my life as a someone who has a brain injury. So I'm a little bit like, I forgot the name of this gentleman who was talking about living in the moment and also like about spirituality. So I love to share my my life, like with some hope and some desire for people to find the beauty, like in having a brain injury. As I always said, without like having a brain injury, I will never have found my gift. And there's so many valuable lessons and gains that I have because I have a brain injury.
Yes. And if anybody is actually, I'm gonna put it out there, France. If anybody does want to know a little bit more about France and her art and her journey into becoming an artist, you can go ahead and take a look back at one of our community meetings. Mm-hmm. France was a panelist for our. Let me just do the background counting, the April community meeting. And she talks a lot about that. And then there are people asking where her art can be seen. So if you go to www.biz.ca, /art/France-Theriault, then you can go right to her link. Otherwise, you can go to biz.ca/art, and it will have a list of all of our artists, and you can click and take a look through their work. Thank you so much. So next, I want to introduce the work of Emily Nicole Causey. Emily is completing her final year in secondary studies. She is transitioning into university to pursue software engineering. Toronto is her home, and she continues to develop her skills as a survivor of catastrophic brain injury caused by a ruptured arteriovenous malformation at 16 years old. Emily is... Emily won't be here tonight, so we're just going to go ahead and show her art. And so just as I'm speaking, take a moment just to pause through some of her work. It's quite poignant and powerful. The events that ensued were intensive rehabilitation, a craniotomy, and continued therapy. Emily had never dabbled in any form of visual art before her medical event. During her recovery period, she began to explore art as a means of therapy. Her work continues to evolve and is largely focused on self-expression through paint media. Her brain injury opened up opportunities through a renewed lens, and she processes and interacts with her environment. Her paintings continue to intrigue viewers, not only for their creative concepts, but also by offering insight into her life, surroundings, and state of mind. Offering these images up to viewers brings them closer to the artist as they become part of Emily's journey of brain injury, self-expression, exploration, and redefinition.
Emily's work is very powerful, and I'm seeing a lot of comments in the chat right now about how powerful it all is. Someone said the art of a true survivor. Someone else said, Emily, your art is wonderful and the images inspire and encourage me to make art, move me and go straight to my soul. I like to imagine that your images speak to me in order to help me and improve myself and taking care of myself. Thanks for your generosity. So at this time, we will be introducing Cynthia from Alberta. Cynthia is a professionally trained in photography. She has always had an affinity for arts and crafts and has been taught the art of making moccasins after marrying into a Métis family. In 2017, Cynthia sustained a severe traumatic brain injury that left her fighting for her life, and in 1 second of one day, normal came to an end. Cynthia had to relearn a lot of things.
What happened? Sorry. Yeah, Carson. Oh, no, just not talking. Not that I did something wrong. That's Cynthia Carson. Did they show Emily when they were doing it?
I don't know.
Sorry about that. Cynthia had to relearn a lot of things, including writing, reading, managing stairs, even putting jam on toast. Gone were the days peering through a camera, looking for a great subject, or getting lost in crafting detailed beadwork. Now her art is a can in a world of can'ts. Cynthia's motto became, when life is filled with things you can no longer do, you need to find something you can do. Inspired by a piece of native art by an unknown artist, she decided to use up some spare leather to just do something. Something that would allow her to work on cognitive function, fine motor skills, concentration, endurance, and so much more. Cynthia's pieces are created by spending very short periods of time on them before calling it a day. Each piece is significant. Creating it has helped Cynthia to redevelop lost skills, to work through trauma, and to rediscover the joy of creating. Please welcome Cynthia.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you, Cynthia.
Okay, so yes, each piece, in the beginning, I just started cutting away and trying to do something. It had nothing to do with making art. And this is something that developed over time. And each piece has a specific meaning to me. Like this gorilla, for example, I called it confidence. And the meaning is kind of like, when you suffer a brain injury, you lose your confidence and it's completely shattered. But little by little, you're able to rebuild that confidence and that strength that is deep inside of you that you might not even be aware of. Yeah, so you can be just as badass as this gorilla looks. That's the point. Like you can rebuild that confidence and that strength and you dig so deep inside of you. You have strength in you that you might have not realized. And I portray a lot of my art in animals just because I find humans in general haven't got a clue that they have strength deep within. They don't believe in themselves. They will see a tiger or a leopard or any kind of animal that's like that is a really strong animal, but they don't see it within themselves. I portray a lot of my things in animal form. This cow, on the other hand, is based on the memory I had of a Highland cow who stuck her head through a window, which is why it's kind of overlapping with the matting. just because, you know, this cow got stuck and it was a fluffy cow in a window. So yeah, like everything means something to me. And I try to put my meaning into it, like the dancing shoes. And I have some ballerinas. I made them because even if you can't physically dance right now, you can still let your soul dance. You can still let music come in and let it cheer you up. I had like a walker when I came home. My husband had to help me to go to the bathroom, to go up and down the stairs. I couldn't do these things on my own. I had to learn a lot of things. And I don't know what my style is going to be in the long term, but right now I learned, I work with leather mainly, and sometimes I put, it's a bit of mixed media. Leather doesn't rip easily. So I like working with leather because it's easier for me, even though it's hard because you need to cut it. But yeah, if you go to the website, you will see a description of each piece and how it felt for me, like the gorilla, the leopard, as well as the dipchat of the leopard and the tiger. They're all part within my strength within series. This piece here is I call it Melania's Strengths, and it literally is just a piece because every single night I listen to very calming music that helps my soul calm down. That's what it means to me. And I know that whoever will maybe buy them one day, these pieces might mean something completely else, and that's perfectly okay. I did start this journey because at the time, I kind of fell through the cracks. I'm the case that falls through the cracks because I got injured at work. So theoretically I should have been with WCB, but I ended up with public health care, and they were kind of ping pong balling me to each other. So in the end, I just fell through the cracks and didn't get really any rehab at all. So I saw this piece of native art and I thought like, hey, you know what? I have a lot of leather from my moccasin making days and beads. I can do this. And no, I could not do the same at the time, but it wasn't about that. It gave me something to do, and I'd spent like 5 minutes or something like that. And I just tried. And over time, every little bit I do, it adds up to these pieces. It doesn't matter if I can spend an hour today or if I can spend 20 minutes or any amount of time, it adds up to these pieces. And I like doing it because I can set my own time. I guess my style is still developing, and I never know what I'm gonna do next. So yeah, I hope you like them and enjoy them. And no matter what you do, never ever give up, even if everybody in the system is against you. Like, this is my rehab because I didn't get that rehab that I needed. And so even if you're the person that is between the cracks because of whatever system stuff that's out there, it's not fair and all that, never give up on yourself. Keep going. Find whatever works for you. This is my thing. That helped me rediscover my love of creating something. I did not do this beforehand. And I don't know. You know, like, I just want to let you know, like, yourself, there is hope. So keep going. Keep going. Like, you're awesome.
It's so inspiring, Cynthia. You know, I have to say, though, just because knowing that your media is, or your medium is leather, knowing how challenging it is to actually work with leather, with my own experience, your work is absolutely astounding. Some of the comments that were coming in as you were talking and showing your art, someone had said, I can see and feel how you develop your concept into something expressive. And so it's touching people. Someone said the gorilla piece is very powerful. Our very own Laura Bellin says, the cow is awesome. So I can almost hear her giggly voice. Someone else has said, you have lovely art, that they love your resiliency. You're inspiring. And again, you're amazing. Your message is amazing. Your art is amazing. And some people are also just acknowledging that struggle to go through the rehabilitative journey. And someone else has just popped in saying that your words are echoed in your art. Thank you so much for being here tonight, Cynthia. It's absolutely incredible. I'm going to... So next, this is a lovely member of BIST. And I'm super excited to welcome Roseanne. 15 years ago, Roseanne had a brain tumor the size of a baseball removed. Shortly after the tumor was removed, she was diagnosed with an acquired brain injury. Two neuropsychological assessments indicated that she had suffered some cognitive brain damage, and an ophthalmologist diagnosed her as partially visually impaired due to the removal of the tumor. Her optic nerves were torn. Optic nerves don't regenerate. She was deemed unable to work, and this is part of her story. Please welcome Roseanne.
Thank you, Melissa.
Thank you, Roseanne.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to read my poem. The name of my poem is called Please Don't Judge Me. If I start from the very beginning, my story will be hard for me to say, even though so much time has passed, I still find myself frustrated, overwhelmed, and crying on any given day. So here is my story as far back as I can go. I knew I felt my brain had changed somehow. Then came the knock on my door, and the answers had arrived now. As explained to me by an occupational therapist, an acquired brain injury therapist, and a social worker sat down and informed me how my brain will now function and how my life will now be, I got up from my chair and said to them upon leaving, I refuse all their help and said, please don't judge me. I sit on my own with no memory of things that I do. I can't read a book because I have no memory of that too. I go to the grocery store. My vision is poor due to the acquired brain injury. The people in the aisles just stare at me. All I asked of them was, please don't judge me. I have a hard time talking on the phone, and the man starts yelling at me. All I asked of him was, please don't judge me. My former co-workers visit with me and speak with me loudly as if I could not hear what they had to say. What kind of foolishness is this? Why this way? They looked into my eyes so close to my face. They saw what they wanted to see. All I asked of them as they were leaving was, please don't judge me. I tried to put together something to eat.
On my dad's street.
It's so hard for me to do because my ingredients are so incomplete. I must let this go. Please let this be. I must remember, please don't judge me. Being alone and afraid, I feel there is nothing I can do. Oh, yes, there is. Get up off your butt and make that phone call to the ABI team so they can begin to help you. The team came back to my home and sat with me. All they asked at the conclusion of their discussions, with smiles on their faces in unison, please don't judge me. After they left, I began making some changes in my life, you see. Please not worry. All for the good. Please don't judge me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Roseanne. That was so lovely. And I'm so glad you're here. And yes, and everyone, I'm sorry, we tried to play the words as Roseanne was saying them and ran into some difficulty. They are on our website. And Roseanne, you read it so beautifully. I think that was amazing.
Thank you.
So wonderful. Sorry, Melissa, are we going to move on to Artsy Paint?
Yes, we're going to. So, my apologies. Okay, so. So next I would like to just take a moment to introduce one of our newest members of a community all the way from Utah. I want to take a moment to introduce Rebecca from Artsy Paint.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm really excited to be here. I'm kind of nervous. I haven't shared my art with a lot of people, but I made this movie, but there's not really much sound to it. Enjoy my art. Can you make it big? So I painted before my car accident when I got a brain injury, and I couldn't paint. I couldn't read. I couldn't do very much right after. And it took me a long time to paint again because when I tried to paint, I couldn't. I love to paint watercolors, and all I could do was tape my paper down, and that was it. I couldn't mix the colors. I couldn't paint. And it was really, really hard for me to even bring myself to start to paint again because I hated abstract art. I love painting realistic landscape, people, cultures, and had the hardest time convincing myself to just be willing to drop paint on paper. And it took a long time. But painting was so healing for me, and it was one of the only things that helped calm down the head on fire pain that I had for months and still have sometimes. So yeah, I love to paint. And something recent that I've done is I've been working on this one's one of my favorite ones. That's one of the very first paintings that I did when I convinced myself to start to paint again. And I discovered that creativity still exists, that I still am creative, just in a different way, and that's okay. My art has become different. I'm more impressionistic. I don't really look at images and just paint from my head. These are all images that I imagined when I was unable to be in the mountains hiking or where I wanted to be. And I discovered that a lot of the creativity that came out was because I just let go of those expectations of what I wanted the painting to be and just allowed myself to create. And a lot of my paintings were, as I imagined my brain healing, it kind of started actually happening. I know that that works. If you really believe something, it really can happen. Because I saw it happen with my art when I started being able to paint mountains again. And recently I created a hope resource guide. It has over 40 free resources, specifically for people who have a brain injury, but also for anyone who has any invisible injury or just wants more hope and happiness in life. And I'll put the link in the chat, but it's free and I wanted to share that. It will be on the website too if you look at that later. That's my art. Does anyone have any questions?
Thank you so much, Rebecca. There are so many comments about how beautiful your art is. Everyone is so moved by it. Someone said that they view it as peace and healing. They're so grateful for you for sharing your art with us. You're very inspiring. There's so much to see in the abstract. Someone said, thank you for having the courage to share your art, Rebecca. One of your landscapes reminded me a little bit of some imagery that really stood out to me when reading The Lord of the Rings.
I love thanks.
There's lots of thanks there. I'm not seeing any questions just yet.
Yeah, I kind of laughed as well. I kind of giggled to myself too when I heard that last comment, because I was kind of thinking as well that, you know, it's it reminds me of kind of like a deep dive into landscape, kind of mirroring what I imagine Utah to be like.
I've had people ask me that, so that big one right there, that's a print of my art. And I've had people ask me, is that Provo Canyon?
Oh!
They're all paintings for my head. I just wished I was in the mountains and imagined the mountains that I'm surrounded by. Rebecca. I have prints and postcards available if anyone wants a small.
Someone said, Rebecca, your art motivates me to find my own creativity again. Can you say more about how you accessed it again?
Just go for it. So my cousin convinced me to paint again. She said, I'm willing to go. And I didn't want to waste my watercolor papers because it's expensive. So I ripped it into four small pieces and I was like, okay, it's going to be trash. I'm going to throw it away. Thank goodness I didn't throw it away. I've kept it. But yeah, just go into it with the expectation of not worrying if it's out good or not and being okay to throw it away, and you might actually want to keep it and find it's beautiful. And practice. It took a lot of painting to get to the mountains again, not just dropping water.
Absolutely. Someone else said, this is so beautiful and loving. I'm very grateful to be with you in this artistic circle and see all of the smiles and art and poetry and hear all of the dialogues. Someone else also said, I would love a copy of your artwork on a postcard. It would be so beautiful.
Thanks. I have my Instagram right there, myartsypaint, and I just started a website, myartsypaint.com. So you can get the free download on there or postcards if you want to.
Excellent. Thank you everyone for being a part of this night. I'm so honored to be here tonight. There was so much incredible talent from all of our members. I want to take a moment to thank all of this evening's artists for coming and sharing their work in your own words. I also want to ensure we make space for those who are not able to attend but still contributed their art in honor of Brain Injury Awareness Month. At this time, please direct your attention as we present additional work from our artists.
We have a poetry reading and then we're gonna show the art, and it's a pre-recorded reading by Sonam, and it is very is very powerful. Just one moment, please. Oops. Okay.
A mighty injury, a shattered world, an unexpected new emergence, scared and frightened brain with old important memories, actions aligned according to karmic principles. These actions we take bear fruit and perhaps innocent. We are front-wheeling a mind that is useful and new, a mind that is open, able to feel more deeply, experience the environment sensitively. The shadows move outside and inside and within us. As the light is our guide, a still source, a gleam, a lamp. The brain injury can become an awakening, creation and amending between the old and new. Perhaps slower, either way, solaced by good people. Mind working, generating thoughts, ideas, and words. Views carry and change with the winds of cosmic wisdom. Openness, love, and grace have more room to flow into. An invisible injury sensed internally. An invisible injury sensed externally. Something mighty to hide and to share vigilantly. I grab the hand of my man, my sister, and I smile. It's going to be very fine for souls who love.
Thank you, Mary, for making sure that that got slipped in. A lot of people are making comments about Sonam's poetry and just how powerful it is. So I think at this time, Mary, if you're ready, we will go ahead and we prepared a just a video, just to highlight some of the work from some of the artists that could not be here tonight. But I feel like, or we all feel like, all of their work is absolutely incredible, and we want to make sure that we can make space for them as well. So here you are.
It's time for-
absolutely incredible. I'm just reading through some of the comments, and you know, it's so incredible to have this space where, you know, everybody feels like they have space and they're feeling supported and part of a huge community and feeling that encouragement. The talent in this group is absolutely phenomenal. And I mean that truthfully, it's demonstrated here tonight. And I want to thank you, but just before we go, I want to take a moment in recognition, because some, you know, hidden disabilities are not really, you know, apparent in others, and there is a need for awareness and self-advocacy and representation of the hidden disability community. As a symbol of Canada's commitment to our hidden disability community, a national hidden disability symbol will act as both a self-advocacy tool and a social, cultural, and systemic transformation tool. So BIST has actually joined a movement forward to help spread awareness and support in the development of a recognized hidden disability symbol. And at this time, I just ask you to turn your attention to this video for some more information and how we can all join in forces to create social change.
Hi everyone, I'm Laura Bridges, and I'm one of the founders of Hidden Disability Symbol Canada. I've been a member of the hidden disability community since 2005, when a car accident left me with multiple hidden disabilities, cognitive, physical, and emotional. I've learned to live with these disabilities, and I assure you that I am happy. I think that my happiness is rooted in accepting my disabilities and learning from what they have taught me. And I decided to share these learnings with you now. First, I'm not alone. It seems that every time my disabilities come up in conversation, the people I'm speaking to say they either have a hidden disability themselves or they know someone else who does. Hidden disabilities affect all of us. They do not discriminate. Second, people make assumptions about how we sound and how we look. In the first few years after my injury, I became so tired of people saying to me when they learned about my disability, "But you look so good." It's as if people don't believe someone can be disabled if they can't see or hear the disability. And we get accused of faking it and malingering. So I decided that I need to help people become more aware of hidden disabilities. And in 2010, I developed my own hidden disability symbol, and I share it for free on my hidden disability Facebook page. Third, even though I can walk, talk, see, and hear, I face barriers every day, multiple times a day. But these barriers are not the barriers most people think of. They are not buildings that need ramps, or doors that need automatic openers. The barriers I face are about the tasks I'm doing and the place or environment that I'm in. If it is too complex, too long in duration, or too intense, my brain just shuts down. So I've also decided that I need to do whatever I can to help make people aware that complexity, duration, intensity, and many other factors are barriers for many, if not all, members of the hidden disability community. And fourth, most people with hidden disabilities lead small lives. In 2010, I did a survey of over 300 members of the hidden disability community, and 95% of them told me that they avoid places, events, and situations on a regular basis. They also told me that using my symbol was helpful when they needed to ask for assistance, and it helped them feel better understood, be treated better, and feel more confident. So in 2019, I decided that it was time to ask the Government of Canada to adopt and promote a national hidden disability symbol. It's not my intention that the national symbol be my symbol, but it is my intention that whatever the national symbol looks like, it helps the members of the hidden disability community achieve equitable inclusion and barrier-free living. So please join our movement asking the Government of Canada to adopt and promote a national hidden disability symbol. It is time, it is right, it is needed.
So for more information on the hidden disability symbol, please visit our website, www.bis.ca/projects-advocacy for links to the HDC and ways you can help. Thank you to all of our artists for attending this evening and sharing your work with all of us here tonight. Your talent is incredible and we are humbled by your work. I also want to thank everyone here tonight who came in support of our artists and our community, which is getting wider each year. We look forward to ways we can grow and support each other as we strengthen connections to one another. Also, I would like to remind you all, the CN Tower will be lighting up green and blue in honor of Brain Injury Awareness Month. If you can get out, please take photos and remember to tag BIST and the CN Tower. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. And thank you so much, Noor, for attending tonight. It's so great to have you again at, I believe this is your second event. And so thank you so much. And yes, as Noor said, if anybody can, please do take a photo or even of yourself. And just, I think by sharing and by tagging, we can start to spread the awareness. But also we can start building that sense of community that tonight has demonstrated that we're so able to do with this new virtual world. Again, thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Andrews, for coming out this evening and opening up this incredible evening with all of our artists. Thank you to Melissa Weiger for having us all out here and spearheading such incredible work. And thank you to all the staff at BIST, the members and the artists tonight from across North America. Thank you.
Well done, BIST team. Well done, artists. Well done, everyone. Thank you all.